the Legislative Report. I'm Laura Mano, joined today by Senator Jesse Hamilton, who represents the 20th Senate District in Brooklyn. Today we will discuss with Senator Hamilton his journey to the Senate and his priorities this legislative session. Thanks for joining me today, Senator.
Oh, thank you, Laura. It's always a pleasure to be here with you.
Yeah, nice to have you.
Yes.
So you are recently elected to the Senate,
correct,
but that doesn't mean that you're new to the world of public service.
No, not
Since this is your first time on the show, why don't you give the viewers just a little background of your history and your life in public service so far?
It all started with my mother knocking door to door, for different political elected officials. She had the first federal credit union in the Bronx, and from there, went to college, became a representative on the college level, and then after that, had my MBA, and then in law school, I was the president for the law students at Seton Hall Law School. After that, at the law school, I came back to Brooklyn. And I wanted to give back to the community. Education was key for me and my success. And I joined the community school board. I ran for the school board, became the president. We had 24 schools, 24,000 children. We had the fifth best school, Laura, in New York State, the Crown School for Law and Journalism, which was a crown jewel, an achievement to have the fifth best school in New York State. And then after that, I ran for the district leader position, which I held until last year. So I've always been active in the community, being a graduate of the Civilian Police Academy, being a president of my block association, being the founding member of Crown Heights North Landmarking Association in Brooklyn. So I've always been a public servant, and basically I've been a political community activist.
Great. So go back to what made you decide to run for this office in particular. What was it about your community? Did you feel that there were issues not being addressed, or what kind of made you run for Senate, taking that step to the legislature?
I've always been involved in the community. I worked with Senator Eric Adams. When he came to Albany, I was basically his person to talk to constituent services and talk on his behalf in public speaking engagements. And so it was a natural progression for me. I've always been out there in the community, and I felt I could make a difference actually doing legislation. With my legal background, my business background, I felt that, and also I'm an appraiser. So I felt that I was the best candidate to run for office, and the people spoke clearly when I got elected with 70% of the vote in the district.
So, Senator, how was your swearing-in ceremony? That must have been a big, exciting experience for you.
It was an awesome experience, Laura. I was there with my father, my wife, my mother-in-law, and my children. And my wife and I have been together for 32 years. And Lorna, I love you dearly, baby. And I have my two children, Jesse and Carla. Jesse's 11, Carla's 13. And they're doing exceptionally well in school. After the campaign, my son said, "Daddy, I get it. I'll never be a slacker again in life." And he has a 97 average in school. And my daughter has a 97.875 average in school. So I can't ask for anything more than that, than having two children academically doing well, who are, grounded spiritually, grounded in the community, and they have a great future ahead of them.
Now, right now, since it's your first session, you are in the middle of your first budget process as a senator. You said that you worked for Senator Adams when
yes.
he was here, so you've obviously seen how the budget process works. Mm-hmm. But this is your first time around actually being in the legislative seat.
Right.
So what would you say are your top priorities in the budget? What would you like to see happen for your district, across the state? Talk to me about some of those budgetary issues.
Housing's a key issue. In my district, a lot of people are being displaced with the gentrification process. And gentrification crosses all ethnic groups. It's not just one particular group. People are coming from Manhattan, moving into Brooklyn, and Brooklyn Heights pushing people into Park Slope, Prospect Heights, and from Prospect Heights to Crown Heights. So we have to find a way to have more affordable housing. The 421A exemption is part of the problem, where apartments are being decontrolled at $2,500, which is easy to do. In my Brownsville section of Brooklyn, we have new shelters, people who work every day. So we have people making minimum wage who are living in shelters, and the owner of McDonald's is making millions of dollars. So that's to be some pay equity. In the district and throughout the state itself. Education is a key component. I sat with the commissioner, and they're trying to do the best job they can do, but only 15% of Black and Latino students are graduating college ready. And so we have to change that dynamic, making all students at least 80% ready and prepared for college, because that's the only way you'd be able to live in the community right now. Average studio apartment right now in my district is $2,200 a month. Which is out of the reach of 80% of the people who are living in the community. So housing, education, and raising the minimum wage is something that I'm looking forward to doing, and protecting our hospitals. I have more hospitals than any other senator in the state.
Wow.
And right now the governor has allotted $1.1 billion, And all of a sudden now, you know, I can understand other people throughout the state want some of that money also. But we're the largest county in the state as far as population. And we do have the highest obesity rates, high blood pressure, asthma. And so we need to make sure we also have healthier foods. I met with Richard Ball, the commissioner, to try to get more healthy food from upstate down to my district, which we have a vegetable and fruit desert in our area. So that's something we're trying to do is raise the minimum wage, have affordable housing, and also have healthy food so we can live more healthier and productive lives.
All lofty goals.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the budget process and how you feel it's been going so far? There's been, you know, a lot of talk about things that are different this year as opposed to other years. What's your kind of take on where we're at with the budget right now?
My take is I'm in the Senate. I'm in the minority. And a lot of times the governor, he gave his 30-day budget, gave it out. And a lot of it is just tied into, there's really no transparency how things are done, you know, why certain areas are getting funding and other areas are not. On the Senate side, we don't really have much interaction as on the Assembly side in the Senate. So I would like to see more interaction with the three men in the room. We have Senator Andrea Stewart-Cousins, who is the first woman to be elected to the leader position. And we're talking about women equality, the 10-point Women Equality Act. But here, for the first time, we have a woman in a position of authority who's not being led in the room. So I like to see her in the room. I like to see every leader of any minority group, majority group in the room together. Collectively. This way there's more transparency and everyone feels that they were at the table and were able to voice their opinion on the needs of the community. And I think that's what's not happening now. So I'm hopefully the governor will allow Andrew Stewart-Cousins into the room because you don't want to leave, you know, the women on the backbone of this country. And if a woman's in a position of power, she should not be shut out.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Other than budget, what are your legislative priorities for the 2015 legislative session? Because budget's only one piece of it. So what else are you looking to do for your district?
I'm the ranker for mental health. And mental health plays a large role in many of the deficiencies of people in my community. We have people who are addicted to drugs, but we know they're 40% to 60% likely to have a mental disability. It's a 50% likelihood if you're in prison, you have a mental disability. And then you have the stress of a single parent working every day on a minimum wage, they can't find a place to live. So we all face stress in our lives. Some act, you know, adversely to it. You know, some may drink more, some may move to drugs, domestic violence. So what I want to do is introduce a more mental health psychiatrist in the early stages in the public schools to diagnose and identify those children who may have a mental disability and give them help and put them back into mainstream in society rather than taking them out and grouping them together and they never come back into the mainstream. People, you know, if you're affluent and you have money, it's not a big deal. Your parents send you to a psychiatrist, you get help, and you live a productive life. So many of the people who are on the fringes in our community have mental disabilities, and that's why they're not being as productive as they could be. And so I'd rather put the money on the front end, which is not a lot of money, rather than on the back end, having them in the criminal justice system. And then they never really get acclimated or put back into the mainstream in our community.
So prevention is key for you.
Prevention is key for everybody. And there's a stigma in communities of color for getting psychiatric help. You know, they say, don't worry about it, you'll be okay. It'll work itself out. You know, but some things never work themselves out. So we have to change that dynamic of the stigma being put on going to get psychiatric help. So this way people can avail themselves to going into a center. So rather than having a psych center with a big sign psych center, we would like to integrate that into the regular doctor's office. So, you know, like I'm going to a doctor's visit. And part of that is a sitting down with my psychiatrist, shooting the breeze, and then dealing with my issues that I might be able to deal with myself.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, you were just sworn in January, so you haven't had too much time to get acclimated with every portion of the legislative process. But I'm curious to know what you think is the most challenging piece of being a senator so far.
So far, it's my district. I have Sunset Park. I have Gowanus. I have Park Slope, Prospect Heights, Crown Heights. Flatbush, East Flatbush, and Brownsville. It takes me 45 minutes to travel throughout my district. I know for upstate, that's not a big deal. But I have a diverse community. I have one of the largest Asian population in the state. I have a large Latin population. Then we have the Park Slope trendy setters. And we also have Crown Heights with the largest Lubavitch community in the country and the largest Caribbean American constituents in the country. And then we have Brownsville, one of the largest NYCHA developments. So it's a challenge to meet all the needs of the different diverse groups, but it just shows you the diversity of New York City, how it's a melting pot, and how everybody really wants the same basic ideals. You know, they want to make sure they have, you know, good schools, safe streets, and affordable housing. And that resonates throughout the whole district. And when we bring everybody together, it's just a great feeling to respect others' religions and to respect others' cultures. And it makes me a better person to understand the dynamic, you know, rather than just being in one place in Crown Heights.
Sounds like that might be a similar answer to my next question, but if that's the most difficult portion, what would you say is the most rewarding?
The rewarding part is coming up and advocating and having the groups come up from the city, from my district. And what we're doing now, we're having committees to propose legislation. So the rewarding part is having people sitting down and say, this is legislation that we need to enhance the lives of our community throughout the district. So we have a bottom-up approach to legislation. We have 30 bills in the pipeline right now, and we expect to have more. And the more people come to the meetings and say, hey, I can really write legislation. I had students come up from NYU, from the EOP program, and they were just so excited that I told them, I said, you can make a change in getting funding for SUNY. You know, if you create legislation or draft it, I'll introduce it. And, you know, they actually sat down, they put something together, they created a video, and they were just so excited that they were able to have a voice, that someone actually listened to them. And that's part of what I'm doing. I'm listening to the people and making sure I act on their behalf, not on the special interest groups, not on the lobbyists. I believe I'm gonna stick with the 99% rather than the 1%. And I think that's the dynamic that has to be changed, is dealing with the 99% rather than the affluent 1%.
So what would your message be to your constituents about how they can get involved? Do you, you know, suggest that people reach out to your office? What do you think would be the message that you'd give? Because it can be difficult to get people engaged in their state government. So what would you say to those constituents?
Well, we started a mobile office, the first of its kind. So we go throughout the district. You know, we have broken up the district into five sections, and twice a month we have a mobile office in the five different parts of the district. Going to seniors, going into areas where people have to work long hours, going to the train stations, having a mobile office in the libraries, in the daycare centers. I believe that I have to come to the people. The people are working, they don't have the time. Growing up in a single parent household, my mother didn't have the time. So I understand that. So we have a mobile office, which is great. We have a mailer, we do at least two mailers per month. And then we have a database over 23,000 email addresses. And so every time we have a forum, we always have at least 400 people there. We had an affordable housing forum, it was packed to capacity. People saying thank you for believing in us, thank you for being our voice. They felt that they didn't have a voice. So that's my main objective, and that's to me which is rewarding in helping others who couldn't help themselves. As an attorney, you know, I do pro bono legal services, especially for seniors who are being harassed, who go to the hospital, come back and find an eviction notice on their door. That's an egregious act by landlords who are trying to intimidate and harass seniors, the people who have worked hard, immigrated to this country, who want to live the American dream in their golden years, are being victimized by landlords. And so that's something that I just enjoy helping those people, because when I see an elder senior citizen, I think of my grandmother, I think of my great-grandmother, I think of my great-grandmother who I met, and her grandmother was a slave. So that's what I like to do.
Well, thank you so much for being here today. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to your constituents about what's important to you.
Right.
And we're grateful to hear your story. So right. I wish you luck on the rest of your legislative session.
Laura, it's always a pleasure to being here. I look forward to being with you. You have a bright future ahead of you.
Thanks so much.
Okay, take care.
For more information on Senator Hamilton, please visit hamilton.nysenate.gov.